I'm Tami Boehmer, and I have been living, I like what what we were talking about, living with cancer, because I've been living with stage 4 breast cancer, metastatic, for over 7 years now, and I am proof that there's hope. And when I first started out, I didn't have much hope, and I'll tell you a little bit. I was first diagnosed in 2002 with a stage 2 breast cancer. It wasn't in my lymph nodes. It was considered, you know, my prognosis was excellent, is what my oncologist said. And so I did all the heavy duty chemos. I had a lumpectomy. I did radiation, and I was told it probably wouldn't come back. After 5 years, I was going to be scot-free. And then after that, you know, it was like a little bit after 5 years, and I just celebrated my cancerversary. And I noticed that this was in 2008, early 2008, I started noticing some swelling in my right armpit that would go up and down. And I called my breast surgeon, and she said, oh, it's probably hormonal, you know, don't worry about it. But it kept growing, and it wasn't going down anymore, and I was starting to getting shooting pains in my arm. And so I finally said, I need to get in to see you. And then the balls kept rolling really quickly, avalanche kind of, where, yes, it was determined that I had, it was cancer, and it had spread to my liver and lymph nodes and my chest, and it was stage 4. And at the time, I was actually working at a teaching hospital. My career was in public relations, and so I remember going down and getting my scan results and staring at this report and knowing what it meant. When I saw that it was in my liver, I was really upset. And so I immediately got on the phone and contacted my aunt, who had just been treated at MD Anderson down in Texas, which, you know, the big cancer center, thought they would have something for me. And so we went down there, I got in pretty quickly, and the oncologist there said she didn't have anything my local oncologist didn't have, and that I would most certainly die of breast cancer. She hated to tell me that, but you know, she looked me in the eye with real. And so I knew enough about stage 4. I'd been in a support group. I knew that it was something that was considered incurable, but what she said really pissed me off. And I was like, who is she? How does she know? She doesn't know what kind of person I am. She doesn't know anything about me. And I know people who've lived a lot longer than anticipated. And I've read, I was really excited to see that Bernie Siegel was on the advisory committee for Say Yes, because he's in my book, which I'll talk about a little later, and was a big inspiration for me. And he talked about how the worst thing that a doctor can do is give you a death sentence. You know, I understood, I'm not like a Pollyanna, I know that this is, you know, right now is not a curable disease, but I definitely, you know, I think hope is so important, and I think without hope, what good is it to carry on? And I decided that I was going to do everything in my power to prove this woman wrong. And so I did all kinds of things with diet and supplements. I did my chemotherapy. I did everything that I could. And then I just started to feel kind of empty. I had stopped working. I was in a real stressful job. And I started to feel empty, and I started to feel depressed, and I started worrying about dying. And one thing I learned from my career was the power in people's stories. And then I thought, well, I'm not getting much hope. And I looked at other books, and I didn't see, you know, too many stage 4 survival. There's all these people early stage. And so I decided I was going to collect stories from people all around the country who had beaten the odds, and not just breast cancer, but any kind of stage 4 really, you know, incurable cancers. And so I did all the searching, and you know, I started a blog. It's called Miracle Survivors, and my intention was to get stories. But what ended up happening was I created a community that has just been mutually beneficial for me, and I believe the people have told me for them. And but one of the things, somebody contacted me, and it was, I think it was their PR department from TheraSphere, and mentioned Nancy's name. I was like, oh, that sounds familiar. So she was one of the people I interviewed for my first book, which was From Incurable to Incredible. And I kind of, for me, it was like a support group. And I kind of say it's like a support group in a book, because I would go to support groups and there'd be some people who were really negative and doing really poorly, or they're just, I remember one I went to was just like, just wasn't helpful for me. It wasn't a match for me. So I wanted to create my own support group. And these are all these people who have been doing remarkably well and were positive and were proactive patients and gave back to others and did all this wonderful stuff. So I can't tell you how much it helped me with each person I interviewed, each story I heard. I kept thinking, well, not only is this maybe possible, but it almost seemed like the norm, because all the people I was surrounding myself were these amazing people. And actually, it was Nancy who, I noticed that a few people in the book had gotten TheraSphere, or I don't know, yeah, I guess TheraSphere too. So Nancy, she had come over and she's like, why don't you do it for you? And I was like, I don't know why I didn't put it together, because I said, well, I don't have primary liver cancer. And she's like, no, it's, if you have metastatic cancer too. And I was like, huh. So, I brought it to my doctors. I always make sure as a proactive patient that I have my local doctor, and then I usually go to an NCI designated cancer center where, they really deal with complicated cases like mine. And none of them thought it was a good idea. I did my research, and Nancy got me in touch with Suzanne, and I really believe that, and I try to tell other cancer survivors that nobody knows yourself like you do, your health, your body, and how you feel and what you want to do. And if given all the information, I think it's up to the patient to make the decision. And I had two doctors tell me it was a bad idea, but I pushed for it, and I ended up getting my doctor to give in, and I had it done. I only had one tumor in my liver, and the radiation oncologist there, interventional radiation oncologist there, said that I was actually a really good candidate, and it was like a straight shot from the artery to my tumor. It blasted my tumor away. I hardly had any, I don't remember having any side effects. This was in 2010. And it pretty much got rid of my tumor up until recently. Now, I've been on all kinds of treatments. I think I counted them. I've been on like 9 different treatment regimens, and I've done this this procedure. I've had a total hysterectomy. I've done all kinds of stuff. But I am living well with cancer. And like Suzanne was saying, my daughter was 3 when I was first diagnosed in 2002. She's 16 now. And I'm seeing all these wonderful things, these milestones I certainly don't take for granted. I've been in pretty good health. I've been very fortunate. I have had many friends pass away. I have like a network of people. I did a second book, which you'll see here, that just came out in November. And it's more stories, people who've beaten me on. Suzanne's story is one of them, because I think she has a remarkable story. One of the things that I remember Suzanne saying is, she hitchhikes from treatment to treatment. And that's kind of what I've been doing. And she's like been really inspirational to me. It's like, well, if this stops working, I'll find something else. And I'm always like prepared. Like, what's my plan B? What's my plan C if this stops working? And I'm always, I'm networking. There's an amazing cancer community where we all support each other. And I found the trial, I was on a trial for a drug that has just been approved. And even the pharmaceutical company was telling me they didn't have any trial sites, and I found out from a Facebook group that they did. So I got into this expanded access trial. So there's so much information that is shared among cancer patients that I can't emphasize how important it is to have a network of support. It doesn't have to be a physical support group. It can be online. It could be reading a book. It could be whatever you want it to be. But I've just found it's just the most incredible fellowship that I have. We all are in this together. And I've been lucky, I've found some doctors who they kind of listen to me. And I think that it should be a partnership between you and your physician. And I found that the people that I know, that I, my experience I've come in contact with who do the best, have that kind of partnership. You know, they don't, they get second, third opinions. They, you know, I've been to so many doctors and it can be really confusing. But I feel like, you know, I will have all the, you know, information I need to make a really informed decision. And I believe that that's one reason, besides having hope and faith and wonderful people around me and a mission in life that I feel like I'm following, have all contributed to me still being here and being, you know, relatively healthy throughout this time. So I'm incredibly grateful. I feel, you know, like Nancy was saying, I feel really blessed. And if you are interested in my book, I'll be, you know, selling and signing copies afterwards, but you can read Suzanne's story and hear more about her and that, and more about me and some other great people. So thank you so much.